Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Ride the Thunder by Martha Carr and Michael Anderle, narrated by Amanda Friday. Chapter 1. The front parking lot of Hellion's Fort Riot base almost always looked this empty. This morning, Corporal Idina Moorfield pulled her lime-green Kia Sorento to a stop in the gravel lot and seriously missed the bustling daily activity on Fort Bragg instead. At least on Bragg, it didn't feel like everything was riding on my shoulders when I showed up to work. Hellion didn't employ nearly the number of operators it would have taken for Idina to get lost in the daily grind, because Hellion only employed military personnel with magic, which was a commodity, especially now. And especially because in the next 20 minutes, her Uncle Richard would hand Idina and her unit their mystery mission that he had only briefly mentioned the night before, with the added hint of a caveat that Bravo Team would be taking Hellion's ops to a completely different level by going out of the country. If he'd told me a damn thing beyond that, I'd know how to feel about this right now. She turned off the engine, whipped off her seatbelt, and forced herself not to slam the driver's side door before taking off toward Maine's front entrance. Walking in the crisp November air brought a little more clarity of mind, and she couldn't help but snicker at her thoughts. Who am I kidding? Richard could tell me everything there is to know about what he wants, what he's planning, and who he's trying to manipulate, and I still wouldn't know how to feel about it. None of it ever makes any sense anyway. Her combat boots crunched down on the gravel as she wove through the few cars in the lot, most of which were parked as close as they could get to Maine's front entrance. Despite not having an official Hellion uniform and being encouraged to show up to work every day in civvies, Idina didn't think she'd ever get rid of the boots. Granted, she was already on her second pair in her first year of active duty, but that meant she was doing something right. The rest of her career still seemed like a toss-up, and she wasn't exactly looking forward to the impending briefing Bravo Team had orders to attend 3 hours earlier than they usually had to show up for work. Her wary suspicion must have been written all over her face when she reached the last car on her way to Maine's glass front doors. Then again, she could have had an incredible poker face, and Grossman could have easily pulled her thoughts out of her head without trying. Leaning back against the driver's side door of his car, with his arms folded, Grossman greeted Idina with a crooked smile.
Morning's off to a great start already, huh?
Idina fixed a deadpan stare on him as she caught up to him. Is it that obvious?
I mean, you look pretty pissed.
She flashed him a tight, blisteringly fake grin. Better? Grossman laughed, pushed away from his car, and shoved his hands into his jacket pockets to join her for the rest of the walk inside.
I feel like that's a trick question.
It probably was. Idina wasn't looking forward to this briefing. If it was anything like the last several times Bravo had sat with senior officers, especially with Richard, today's meeting was sure to be as much of a shit show.
Trust me, you're not the only one freaking out about this a little.
Grossman muttered as they stepped onto the front sidewalk. Widening her eyes, she nodded at the glass double doors and the tired, slow-moving figures of the rest of their team waiting inside.
Is that why you've been sitting in your car the whole time?
He snorted.
It's like you know me or something.
Or something. When they stopped at the doors so Grossman could pull one open and hold it for her to step inside first, Idina fixed him with a genuine smile, but much smaller, and thought directly to him, which one of them's the loudest so far? He smirked, then looked away to avoid immediately being teased by the rest of their team for all the knowing looks and private conversations Grossman and Moorfield shared on a regular basis. Not that it wasn't exactly what they were doing, but 0456 was too early to put up with the rest of the team's crap, no matter how good-natured.
Honestly, it's a pretty even match this morning.
Grossman replied in her mind. When he stepped into the lobby after her and let the door close behind him, Idina scanned the room to assess the rest of her team. Bam sat on the floor with his back against Captain Iron's desk, and that was only because Irons wouldn't be caught dead sitting behind his desk outside normal business hours, let alone this early in the morning. Trigger paced back and forth, with her gaze practically glued to the linoleum floor and her hands thrust deep into the pockets of her cargo pants. Wilson and Chandler sat in two plain metal chairs against the right-hand wall beside the closed doors to the small offices, which was weird because there normally weren't any chairs in the lobby. On the other side of one of those closed doors, Edgar's leaned back against the wall and rhythmically thumped the back of his head against it over and over, his gaze as vapid as Trigger's. Sergeant Briggs had taken a position at the side of Iron's desk, sitting halfway on the edge of it, with one thigh thrown over the front corner and his other boot planted firmly on the floor. The slow smack of his gum chewing joined the thump of Edgar's head against the wall and the scuff of Trigger's boots across the floor as the only sounds in the lobby. "Bam doesn't look too hot, though," she thought to Grossman again. He shrugged.
"If you see anybody at the top of their game right now, I missed something."
That almost made her laugh, but she fought the urge and stopped in the lobby center. He was right. Everybody looked like they were as skeptical as Idina of how this next briefing would go. After what they'd been through in the last several weeks alone, every member of Bravo Team expected it to go straight down the toilet. For a moment, it seemed like they were all too caught up in their morbid anticipation to notice that the last two members of their unit had finally joined them. Then Trigger spun in her pacing to head back toward the other operators and muttered, "Okay, run the whole thing by us again." The woman didn't take her eyes off the patterned squares in the linoleum floor, so it was impossible to tell exactly who she was talking to. Grossman nudged Idina with his elbow and nodded at Trigger.
"Oh, so I have the floor now? Great."
Idina cleared her throat. "Okay. Well, like I said, lots of new fun things coming down the pipeline." Trigger interrupted, without missing a step in her pacing.
"That's what he told you, right?"
"Yep."
"We're fucking deploying again. Like out of the States deploying."
Idina wrinkled her nose as she watched the other woman work out her nerves on the linoleum floor.
"That's what it sounded like." "But he didn't tell you that specifically. You fucking guessed."
When Idina didn't have a response for that, Trigger stopped short and whipped her head up to stare at Corporal Moorfield.
"Right?"
"It was a guess that he pretty much verified," Idina replied carefully. "I told you guys about it last night because you deserve to know as much as—"
"I need specifics here, Moorfield."
Trigger snapped her fingers.
"Quotes. Facts."
"Listen, I told you all this as a heads up, not as an order from the colonel to the rest of the team." Idina spread her arms.
"I could be totally wrong."
"Verbatim." Trigger pointed violently at Grossman, and if they'd been standing closer together, she would have been wagging her finger in his face.
"Go."
Widening his eyes, he shook his head.
"I wasn't there."
"I didn't ask if you were there, asshole. I'm telling you to grab the facts."
She jerked her head toward Idina.
"Straight out of the horse's head. Let's hear it."
"Trig, I'm not picking Moorfield's brain because you want answers before a briefing."
"Oh, yeah? How's this any different from all the millions of other times you get all up inside her head for a private little—"
"Jesus Christ, Trigger." Idina huffed and laughed bitterly.
"You need to chill. You need to give us everything you got, because I can't fucking wait around like this without knowing what the fuck's going on."
At the end of her outburst, Trigger whirled again and paced toward the opposite side of the lobby one more time. Edgar snorted, but kept thumping his head back against the wall. Sergeant Briggs' gaze followed Trigger halfway through her next round. Then he turned his head to look at Idina. He didn't do or say anything else, but the hopelessness on his face almost rivaled the desperate terror they'd all seen in their sergeant the day they'd broken into his office and found him in literal pieces.
"Shit. Okay."
Idina looked up at Grossman.
"Verbatim?"
"Yep."
With a sympathetic smile, he set a gentle hand on her shoulder, and a fuzzy little tickle in the back of her mind momentarily drowned out everything else. Now her conversation with Richard last night was drawn to the forefront of her mind, crisp and clear
and as vivid in her memory as if it had happened 20 seconds ago instead of 10 hours. I asked about it being an international mission, and he smirked like an idiot and said he knew it wouldn't be that hard to figure out. Didn't say anything when I asked about going after the source of all monsters, which would have been nice, but hey, it's Colonel McBlair. Idina shrugged. That was the end of it.
Besides the support team bullshit,
Wilson murmured from his chair against the wall.
Right?
Yeah, she nodded. He didn't say anything else about that part. That wasn't exactly true, but it hadn't felt like a good idea at the time to tell the rest of her team that her uncle had said he didn't trust her enough to put together the right team on her own. She was still trying to figure out why he'd made that comment when that wasn't her role with Bravo to begin with. They'd already taken to heart her hints about deploying internationally for another mission and what that might entail, and saying anything about the colonel's blatant insult he seemed to think quite funny would have been Idina complaining at that point. Bravo has enough of that as it is. I don't need to keep adding my shit to that. Beside her, Grossman snickered and immediately tried to cover it up. When she looked up at him, he frowned in apology and sniffed.
The source of all the fucking mobs.
Bam snorted and shook his head, not once lifting his gaze from the floor between his bent knees.
What the hell does that mean?
Guys, look. Idina rubbed her clammy hands on her pant legs, then immediately shoved her hands into the pockets of her light jacket. It was a heads up. That's it. Seriously, if I'd known it would freak you out this much, I wouldn't have said anything.
Man, don't start with that shit.
Chandler's low voice rumbled around the room, and he clicked his tongue before shrugging with one shoulder, the way most people tried to shrug away from an uncomfortable touch on their arm.
Nobody's pissed at you, Moorfield.
Trigger laughed bitterly.
Oh, yeah? You speaking for all of us now, tough guy?
Wilson's grimace was the wordless equivalent of telling her to shut up. Chandler didn't seem bothered by Trigger's snide comments. After months of working closely with the woman, day in and day out, ignoring her attitude practically became second nature for all of them.
I'm saying any of us would have done the same thing is all. Moorfield made the right call. Shit would be even worse if we didn't have any kind of heads up before this.
He's not wrong. Bam finally looked up from his spot on the floor and met Idina's gaze.
If you hadn't told us, I'd hate your fucking guts at the end of this briefing.
He was completely serious, but Idina couldn't keep another tiny smile off her lips.
Yeah, Bam, I'd probably hate me too.
After holding her gaze a while longer, Bam blinked, then jerked his head to the side, like he was trying to avoid a fly or a mosquito buzzing in too close.
Man, I only know one thing right now.
Edgars finally added.
If they ship us out to wherever the fuck, without any intel on what we're looking for, or how the fuck to kill it, I'm done.
Trigger scoffed. Right, just like that. His navy blue beanie had slid slightly forward on his head to cover his eyebrows, but Edgars didn't bother readjusting it when he fixed her with a deadpan stare.
Just like that.
Is that gonna be before or after they ship us out? Trigger had stopped pacing, but it looked like she was about to launch herself across the room and throttle him, which even Edgar's wasn't quick enough to dodge.
Cause they'll stick you in the stockade for the rest of your life if you fucking dip out on U.S. soil.
What stockade?
Wilson might have tried to laugh, but it came out as nothing more than a hissing puff of air.
Hellion stockade, bro. Doesn't fucking exist.
Beside him, Chandler snorted.
Or they might give you Iron's job, without the promotion.
All right.
Edgars finally grabbed the sides of his beanie with both hands and jerked it back into place.
After we get chucked off to Hong Kong, then I'm going full on Kung Fu hustle.
Some of the other operators snickered and shook their heads, and the general air of rigid defeat in the lobby started to dissolve. Trigger wrinkled her nose.
Why the fuck would we deploy to China?
The smiles disappeared, even the barely there one, and the team averted their gazes again. Idina pressed her lips together and glanced at the hallway behind Iron's desk that would take them to their meeting room when it was finally time for their briefing. Leave it to Trigger to kill the mood before it even got started.
The silence started to make even Idina feel itchy. Then Briggs sniffed and cleared his throat.
Godzilla.
At first, nobody realized it was their team leader who'd spoken, and they didn't quite know what to do with themselves in case they were wrong. Grossman was the only one who knew for certain that the weird comment had come from Briggs, and he watched the sergeant for more odd comments with a smirk he couldn't completely hide. Chandler leaned forward in his metal chair, which let out a few groaning creaks under the strain of his immense weight shifting.
Did you say Godzilla?
Briggs stared straight ahead through Maine's glass front doors, although there wasn't anything to see when the sun hadn't risen yet.
You heard me.
There was another moment of silence. Then Bam sighed and would have looked up at their team leader if Briggs hadn't been half sitting on the desk corner above him.
Godzilla's Japanese, Sergeant.
A small smile flickered across Briggs' lips.
At least one of you morons is paying attention.
The rest of the team loosened up again, and a few more chuckles filled the lobby, despite nobody being entirely sure what Briggs was trying to accomplish. Trigger was the only one who still looked pissed.
Fuck me. I'd still take Godzilla over the mothership of mobs any day.
The rest of the team had a good laugh, and the tension broke enough that it wouldn't sink back into silent despair beneath the weight of the unknown again. At least, not before their impending briefing, anyway.
You assholes think I'm joking?
Trigger folded her arms.
Just watch.
Man, that's something you couldn't pay me not to watch.
Chandler said through another low chuckle.
Hey, Sergeant.
Grossman nodded at Briggs.
I think we got a request for Japan. You know, next time we're on leave.
Briggs raised an eyebrow.
You pulled that out of his head, Grossman? Or is that a hunch?
Grossman shrugged and spread his arms. The other operators chuckled, snickered, or smiled silently. Trigger pointed at Chandler.
You know I could take that bitch all on my own, too.
An alarm on Briggs' field watch went off. Scowling down at it, he quickly turned off the alarm, then slid off the corner of Captain Iron's desk onto both feet.
All right, time to nut up.
Thanks, Sarge.
Trigger rolled her eyes. You're really making this day super. He walked past her and the other operators to head for the hallway toward the meeting rooms.
Yep, that's about to change real fucking fast.
Idina and the rest of her team exchanged glances as they followed their team leader into what felt like another joke waiting to flop. They fell in line anyway and walked forward into yet another mission briefing. Idina and Grossman brought up the rear of their loose, shuffling line, and he grabbed her hand to give it a quick squeeze.
If it's anything like what he told you last night, it can't be all that bad. At least we know what to expect.
She appreciated his attempt to stay positive. Then it occurred to her that she might have built up enough sky-high, impenetrable walls around her thoughts of Colonel Richard McBlair that even Grossman's telepathy couldn't pick up the full spectrum of Idina's relationship with her uncle. Not wanting to let him down harshly, she squeezed his hand before releasing it. Honestly, I wish it worked that way. Chapter 2. The door to their designated meeting room was wide open when Briggs led his team down the hall. The operators of Bravo team didn't expect to be bottlenecked inside it when Briggs and Wilson stepped into the meeting room first.
Dude,
Edgars whispered when their sergeant and Bravo's bald, ridiculously muscular warrior stopped dead.
The rest of us are right behind you, man. Come on.
Briggs cleared his throat and stepped around the right-hand side of the long conference table that took up almost the entire room length. The rest of the team finally managed to squeeze past Wilson to take their seats around the table, sending him weird looks as they passed. Chandler finally had to nudge the bald operator out of the way before Wilson was jolted back into the present moment and shuffled toward one of the empty seats. Idina knew something about this briefing was seriously off when she caught the whiff of thick, strong coffee on her way through the doorway. While the rest of her team blocked out the view of the rest of the table in front of her, she got a good look at the small folding table on the left side of the room. The hiss and rumble of a fresh pot of coffee
finishing its brew cycle, rose over the shuffles, squeaks, and creaks of Bravo operators settling into their swiveling office chairs. The folding table also held an array of actual mugs, all mismatched in color and size, plus creamer, sugar, and all the extras one might need for making the perfect cup of coffee. She could only stare at the table in confusion. If that's a peace offering, it's not nearly enough to get us through this. Then Grossman passed her on the left and tugged her sleeve on the way, reminding her that this was the part where they sat and waited to be told what they were doing, when, where, and hopefully how. So she quickly headed after him to take the empty seat beside him at the end of the table. The coffee smelled amazing, which made it that much harder not to swivel right around in her chair and pour herself a cup without thinking about it. Maybe it's not a peace offering. Maybe it's a trap or a diversion. Get Bravo nice and cozy with great fucking coffee, and they'll be distracted enough not to pay attention to all the shit we're about to drop on them for this next mission. That train of thought might have made sense, if it weren't for two other minor details that felt enormous. The first was that the meeting room had been empty until Bravo had stepped through the door. No officers sat at the far head of the table, nor were there any squadron support staff present. Not that Captain Irons would have been much of a welcome party anyway, but even Captain Carlyle sitting at the head of the table to at least greet them with a good morning would have made this whole thing less weird. Then again, maybe not. The second weird detail that had made Briggs and Wilson stop dead inside the door was the half-dozen rectangular pink boxes lying open in a line down the center of the conference table. Inside each box were a dozen donuts in almost every variation imaginable. Chocolate, plain, old-fashioned, white, brown, pink, purple, blue, tan frosting, sprinkles in every conceivable color, powdered sugar, cinnamon sugar, and even a few jelly-filled. Idina had never liked the latter. The unexpected breakfast spread made the meeting room look more like an early morning kid's birthday party than the crapshoot of a Hellion mission briefing they all expected. Still, not a single officer stepped through the open door. After a few moments of shocked silence, Chandler cleared his throat.
So, are we supposed to be here?
Briggs looked at his watch again, then pulled out his phone to scroll through and double-check whatever messages were there.
Yep.
Trigger leaned forward in her chair and studied the vast array of donuts on the table.
These are for...
Don't touch the fucking donuts,
Briggs said blandly, although there was enough warning in his voice to make her sit back in her chair again. Then the seconds kept ticking away, and nothing changed. Eventually, several operators turned in their chairs, swiveling toward the table with the fresh pot of coffee to eye the setup there.
9 mugs, Edgars muttered.
8 of us,
Briggs replied flatly. It didn't sound anything remotely like permission to pour themselves a steaming mug of coffee to help keep them awake through this ridiculousness. Someone started drumming their fingers on the armrest of their chair. Bam alternated between popping his lips and jerking his head away from something no one else could see or hear. He reached up to swat at whatever it was, and Idina tried not to stare at him.
If he's got lice or fleas or something, we're not going to make it through the rest of whatever the hell this is.
Grossman chuckled softly beside her, then pushed his wheeled chair away from the table and stood. No one bothered to hide their curiosity at this point, and the entire team stared at him as their telepathic operator poured thick, steaming black coffee into the first mug. Then, leaving it completely black, he turned back toward the conference table and leaned forward. Idina could have imagined it, but she was sure she saw Trigger and Chandler tilt their heads back to covertly sniff the air, while Grossman stretched his arm over the table, set the mug down on the other side, and slid it toward Briggs. She wouldn't have been surprised if Wilson started drooling, or someone's stomach growled and never stopped. At first, their sergeant stared at the mug of black coffee, the only way he ever drank it, wafting aromatic steam into his face, By the time Briggs decided not to waste a good thing, Grossman had already turned back toward the coffee pot to fill another mug. Half the team watched Briggs drink the coffee no one was sure had been brewed for them, and the other half diligently watched their telepathic operator fixing up the next cup, this time with creamer. Idina fell into the latter half, and she failed miserably when she tried to hide a smile.
Nobody wants to be the one breaking the rules right now. Not after the mess we got put in. Hell, the mess the officers put themselves in. But if Briggs doesn't say no, nobody else will either.
Grossman fought back another laugh as he turned toward the conference table again, this time with two made-up mugs of early morning caffeine in hand. The first went across the table to Trigger, and the second skipped over Edgar's before stopping in front of Bam. Edgar's lifted his chin to catch a whiff of the coffee, but he didn't say anything when it was clear that next cup wasn't for him. Trigger pulled her mug toward herself and wrapped both hands around it. Then she leaned protectively over it, like a mama bird in her nest, surrounded by half a dozen snakes, and narrowed her eyes. Briggs sat back in his chair, propped one elbow on an armrest, and continued to enjoy his coffee from a much more relaxed position. As Grossman returned to work on two more drinks, Bam stared at the cup in front of him and swallowed thickly.
This has to be some kind of sick test.
If it is, we passed and they failed,
Briggs replied in all their minds. Bam whipped his head up to stare at their sergeant, not having expected all their thoughts to be blasted so openly at each other without warning.
Right there with you, Sergeant,
Chandler added, as Grossman set a mug in front of him next.
Way I see it, the colonel's late, and we're doing our jobs. They can't leave shit out like this and expect us not to enjoy it.
Edgar snickered, then immediately dropped his smile and stared wide-eyed at the mug Grossman placed right under his nose. When he inhaled deeply, his eyelids fluttered, and he seemed to melt into his office chair as he wrapped both hands around his coffee.
Goddamn.
Wilson sat back in his chair with a smirk when Grossman silently presented his coffee.
Watch, they're gonna take the price of coffee out of our paychecks or some shit.
Trigger's loud slurping filled the conference room. Then she let out a contented sigh and muttered,
"Fucking worth it."
That got everybody smiling a little more, and the tension in the meeting room dissipated. For now, they were a unit of 8 Hellion operators sitting together in a room with a bomb-ass pot of coffee to split among them. Whatever happened next hadn't happened yet, and that was enough. When Grossman finally sat again, he set a black coffee down in front of Idina, then brought his mug to his lips. Nobody said a thing about their telepathic operator making each of their drinks exactly how they liked it. Nobody mentioned the donuts either, partly because Briggs had told them not to, and partly because that would have taken it too far. Idina sipped her coffee and looked around the room at the rest of her team, all of whom had abandoned worrying about what they expected their next mission to be, so they could enjoy something so ridiculously simple like hot coffee at 0515, without saying a thing.
At the very least, we have this.
It felt like they sat there for at least an hour, but the coffee wouldn't have lasted nearly that long. Finally, someone else's footsteps echoed toward them from the hallway. Idina and her team all looked at each other in anticipation, but now they'd at least had the chance to get a little more comfortable and wake up on what felt like their own time.
That was probably the point of all this, wasn't it? Get us nice and happy before the colonel drops another serious bomb he knows we won't like.
The same sentiment seemed to be reflected on every other operator's face, although Grossman had since switched off their telepathic team comms. All anyone heard was the ticking clock above the door, and those echoing footsteps drawing steadily closer. Now it was a lot easier to take their cues from their team leader, and because Briggs didn't change a thing about his posture or the way he sipped his coffee, neither did anyone else. Bam was the only one who still seemed a little out of sorts. He kept blinking harshly, scrunching one eye shut and the other, and occasionally jerking his head away from nothing before pulling himself back together. Then he swatted a few times at something beside his left ear
and grimaced at his coffee. He never noticed Idina's concerned glance. Then Bravo Team's short-lived, pre-brief lounging was over. Colonel McBlair barreled through the open door with a stack of papers in hand, which he scrutinized fervently, without looking up at the team he'd ordered to be here 20 minutes earlier.
Everybody relax. As you were. Don't get out of your damn seats.
Richard reached for the doorknob and missed twice before his fingers finally closed around it to shut the door. He still didn't look up from all the papers.
Everybody's here? Great. Excellent. I'll only be a moment.
He hurried around the right-hand side of the table, nearly walking straight into several chairs before correcting himself at the last minute. When he reached the head of the table, he pulled out a chair for himself, slumped into it, then scanned several more pages in quick succession, without saying another word. Idina and the rest of her team exchanged quick looks. So far, this hadn't started like any of the most recent disgraces they still called briefings and debriefings, but that didn't necessarily mean it could only get better from here. Richard made them wait another 5 minutes before he looked up from his papers. When he did, he looked momentarily confused, like he'd forgotten where he was and why he was there. Then he dropped the stack onto the table and fixed the members of Bravo Team with a very Richard-like smirk.
It looks like you already have. Corporal Grossman, how about filling up that last mug for me?
Sir.
Grossman stood from his chair and turned toward the folding table with the coffee set up.
How do you like your coffee?
Richard glanced at him before his luminous green gaze moved on to study the other faces around the table.
No need to ask, Corporal. You can figure that out on your own.
Grossman stiffened and grabbed the last coffee mug on the table. He did a decent job of keeping his thoughts inside his own mind where they belonged, but Idina had a pretty good idea of what he was thinking anyway.
Shit, our commanding officer basically told him to read his mind and make him a cup of coffee. What is this?
Her uncle didn't seem to think anything was wrong with a single part of this scenario. That was until his gaze landed on the open boxes of donuts that hadn't been touched. He paused, frowned, then looked back and forth between Bravo and the 6 dozen breakfast treats.
What's wrong with them? With what, sir?
Briggs asked casually. Somehow he'd managed to play off this whole thing like it was another regular day at Riot now, smirking as he raised his mug to his lips again.
The donuts, Sergeant.
Richard narrowed his eyes at their team leader, then reached out without looking when Grossman brought him his coffee.
8 Hellion operators before dawn, 1 goddamn enormous pot of coffee, and nobody's touched the food.
Grossman walked stiffly back to his chair beside Idina and looked more confused than ever. She tried to get his attention to see if he'd picked up something incredibly weird out of the colonel's mind, but he grabbed his mug with both hands and wanted to focus only on his coffee for now.
Moorfield.
Almost everyone at the table jumped at Richard's sharp bark, and Idina looked up at her uncle with wide eyes.
Sir? What's wrong with the donuts?
It took everything she had not to roll her eyes. I wouldn't know, sir.
Jesus Christ. I'm a quarter of an hour late and it's the end of the goddamn world.
He stood abruptly from his chair and reached as far as he could over the closest donut box to the next one beyond it.
Normally, I wouldn't announce something so plain and boring, but I'll tell you something right now.
He finally got the donut he wanted, sat back in his chair, and shook the pastry at Idina and her team.
Nothing stands up to a good old-fashioned glazed donut. I mean nothing.
Every operator watched their commander bite off a third of his donut in one go, but Colonel McBlair stuffing his face in front of them wasn't nearly enough to convince the team that this wasn't a test. Before taking his next bite, Richard paused to eye their reactions again.
That bad, huh?
Then he nudged aside the closest bright pink box with his knuckles.
I didn't buy 6 dozen fucking donuts to make you sit there and watch me eat every goddamn one of them. No tricks. I'm not trying to poison you. This isn't coming out of your paychecks. Eat.
Everyone looked at Briggs next, who who took the colonel's words as an order and grabbed the closest box to him. He snatched a sweet treat for himself, like they were all the same, then slid the box down the table toward Wilson, sitting beside him. Then the donuts were going around the table, boxes sliding with a rustle across the wood laminate surface, and the meeting room filled with the sound of slow chewing and coffee being slurped. Idina wasn't remotely hungry, but for some reason, it felt like the right thing to do.
What does that mean, the right thing to do? We're all sitting here like he's holding a fucking gun to our heads, but it's somehow not as bad because it's sugar-coated.
She took a chocolate donut anyway, and from the first bite, didn't think she'd be able to finish it. Everyone waited for the next step in this insanely odd mission briefing, which normally would have included a conversation without all the treats. Richard wiped his mouth with a napkin, grabbed a second donut, and took a bite before setting it down on another napkin and clearing his throat.
You won't believe the preliminary intel the brain's been picking up for us over the last few weeks. What?
He stopped when his attention caught on Sergeant Briggs, which derailed his entire opening.
I can tell you have something to say, Sergeant. Let's clear the air before I get rolling.
Briggs stared at the colonel, then gave in and gestured vaguely toward the meeting room's door.
I thought we might have been waiting for someone else to join us, sir. Of course you did.
Richard snorted.
You assumed that I don't give a shit, even if we were. Which would have been a correct assumption on your part, by the way.
He took a long drink of his coffee, blinked heavily, then shook his head.
The door's closed, Bravo. You're here, I'm here. Donuts and coffee. Quite frankly, I don't think the others give a flying magical fuck about the crucial work we're doing here. And I do mean crucial, especially today. Any other questions?
No one had anything else to say, even if it was incredibly tempting to correct the colonel and remind him that no one had interrupted or corrected him in the first place. Wilson slid another box of donuts toward himself for seconds.
That's what I like to hear.
Richard cast each of them a knowing smile and nodded.
I think you're gonna love this one.
Chapter 3.
Maybe if Idina hadn't spilled the beans the night before by alerting her unit to this potential international mission, Bravo team would have been more excited by this particular briefing. They had celebrated an incredible game win against Delta team the night before, all while figuring out what their experimental new Hellion gear did in the process. Now that they were here, Idina felt a little guilty for sharing the unconfirmed details with her unit before they met here this morning. It dampened the mood. While Richard noticed something different about the team's dynamics this morning versus their victory party last night, he didn't say anything about it. She still couldn't eat more than one bite of her chocolate donut.
As I was saying,
Richard sat up straighter in his chair and restarted his planned reveal.
Intel, from the brain, over the last few weeks. But if we'd known where to look before then, I'm sure we would have seen the same level of activity spikes out there, which only makes me that much more confident.
Grinning, he looked at each operator, then clicked his tongue.
Tough crowd this morning. I thought the coffee would have helped turn your brains on, but I was wrong. Here's the deal.
Moving like a professional card dealer, only with sheets of paper, Richard flicked stapled packets of printouts across the table toward each operator in turn. When Idina slammed her hand down to catch hers before it flew off the table, she couldn't begin to guess what she was looking at. The top page held a multitude of graphs that didn't look anything like the light-up data Richard had shown her in his basement lab, at home, a few days ago.
Sure, great plan. He'll hand over a bunch of crap we can't read and expect us to go along with whatever he says it means.
Grossman looked at her from the corner of his eye and raised an eyebrow in curiosity, but she shook her head.
I'm a little bitter. That's all this is.
Richard continued.
To be clear, the handouts are only to save my ass. Feel free to chuck 'em.
As if he thought they needed a demonstration, he grabbed the remaining packets in one hand
and tossed them carelessly over his shoulder to let them flutter to the floor. Several operators snickered at that, and the colonel finally felt like he had an audience again.
Here's what we know.
There have been some insane energetic disruptions coming up on the brain's feed. Yes, that's the official description, because I really can't say much more than that. Other than if these spikes of magical activity were coming from anywhere in the continental United States, Bravo would have most likely already been ordered to engage at this point. They're not. So lucky you. Idina got several looks from different unit members, and all she could do was shrug as casually as possible, while pretending to focus on her uncle's next words. Well, at least now Trigger has her proof. Richard took another bite of donut, washed it down with coffee, then smacked his lips.
It's not just any kind of activity spike either, or even a series of them.
I honestly haven't seen anything like this since the technology for spotting this sort of thing was invented in the first place. This means it's most certainly something specifically suited for Bravo and its assorted skill sets.
Everybody with me so far?
Sir.
Edgars raised his hand part way and got a nod from Richard.
We're not going anywhere in Asia, are we?
Briggs snorted and immediately grabbed a stack of napkins to press against his nose. The rest of the team snickered, and Richard grinned.
I see there's already been some speculation about this. Understandable. I did get you quite a bit to chew on last night. No, Corporal. Asia's on their own for the time being. This bit of energetic disruption happens to be in and around the vicinity of Western Rossshire, a quaint little spot in the Scottish Highlands, or so I've heard.
Idina couldn't help but sit up straighter at that, and she narrowed her eyes at her uncle, suddenly much more interested in hearing all the details, even though they'd still have access to them after this meeting.
Scotland? Is he serious?
Why Scotland? Trigger asked.
That, Corporal, can only be answered with speculation at this point. I'd much rather let you and your team do the speculating once you arrive on site. I've never been there. Maybe you'll have an even better answer for me by the time you complete this mission.
Trigger looked like she couldn't figure out whether to be insulted or complimented by his reply, so she ended up sulking in her chair instead.
This is Hellion's first international mission. Ever.
Richard continued, eyeing everyone around the table. Also, the first international mission under K4 Shroud in almost a decade, which may or may not mean anything to you.
I will say that you're all lucky enough to have the advantage of previous Shroud presence in the country, at the very least, which makes this a lot easier for everyone. Here's why.
The colonel took his sweet time getting to the next part of his briefing. Now it seemed like he wanted to screw with the whole team for fun, probably because there weren't any higher-ups here to frown upon it. Only when he'd finished yet another donut did Richard continue. We haven't pinpointed the exact location of this massive energy spike, meaning you'll have to dig around on your own once you've got boots on the ground.
International flights are booked and paid for, and no, nobody's flying first class. By the time you walk back out that door, Sergeant Briggs will have all the necessary information for your point of contact on the other side of the pond, as they say. When you reach your operations base in Western Rossshire, Hellion's relative counterparts in the British Army's Royal Regiment of Scotland will give you access to whatever you need. Within reason, of course. However you want to define reason, Sergeant, I'll leave that entirely up to you.
Briggs blinked, then offered the colonel a confused smile, before remembering he normally didn't smile. He normally wasn't given free rein to define within reason for his Hellion team's requirements overseas either. So if any of the operators under his leadership noticed his break in character, they let it slide. They would have to let a lot of things slide to wrap their heads around what was coming next for them. Richard continued,
Beyond that, you'll be more or less on your own, at least as far as any assistance from the British military is concerned. That's not personal, it's who they are. This area,
Idina's laugh quickly turned into a strangled choke, and her unit members gave her odd looks that she thoroughly ignored. Her uncle looked her up and down with a widening smile, then thankfully chose to ignore the moment of unintentional humor so he could finish laying out all the details.
This area of the Highlands is sparsely populated, so the locals are naturally a little more closed off to visitors. On the other hand, that brings the civilian risk factor down by quite a bit. I haven't run the numbers, but I'm sure they're impressive. Meaning Bravo can get out there, do what you do, and hopefully not make too much of a scene that the Scottish government doesn't feel justified in involving themselves. They know we're coming. They don't want to know we're there. On top of that, there isn't a lick of military presence in this area of the countryside. I imagine that has something to do with most people wanting to stay away from the Highlands as much as possible, especially during the last 2 months of the year. So again, lucky you.
But they have, like, electricity, right? Wilson asked. Richard snorted.
You underestimate the Scots. Most people do.
Grossman clenched his eyes shut and stifled another laugh. Idina couldn't tell if it was because he'd caught some other joke of the colonel's, or if the briefing had become so ludicrous now that it was funny. But she understood the feeling either way.
Like Richard's got a bone to pick with the entire country of Scotland. That's a little weird, seeing where he and I come from. But maybe the colonel's having another one of his days.
As if he'd read her mind, or at least picked up on the sentiment behind her thoughts, Richard eyed his niece and chuckled.
The entirety of this mission, from when you step foot off Riot until your boots kiss U.S. soil again, is 1,000% covert. You're going in as civilians. You'll walk around as civilians. If you come upon a few supernatural entities in need of a good ass kicking, you'll kick ass as civilians. Even better, as tourists.
Chandler's low, rumbling chuckle filled the meeting room.
Yes, it's all very glamorous.
Richard discarded his comment with a flippant wave. Our Scottish counterparts have informed me of the potential for a sweep team on British soil, if necessary, but the way they brought it up sounded more like they're expecting to have to clean up after the Americans, most likely for a fee, which, as most of you know, the U.S. Army is not generally in the habit of shelling out. He frowned from the head of the table, then sucked in a sharp breath. I guess what I'm saying here is that your chances of coming home are a lot slimmer if you get on their bad side. So clean up your messes and avoid making a spectacle of yourselves if possible. The goal here is to blend in. Each of you has at least a little experience with attempting to do that. So if you have to, draw on your failures. Trigger snorted and rolled her eyes, but now she was smiling too. Idina downed the rest of her coffee.
Okay, maybe there's one benefit to him wrapping up his insults as compliments, or vice versa.
Worst case scenario, the colonel continued as he gestured at his niece. Look to Moorfield for guidance in that arena.
She looked sharply up at him, and her mouth popped open.
I'm flattered, sir. Really. However you want to look at it, fine.
He shrugged, and some of the operators stifled more soft laughter.
Not that you did anything specific, but I should think blending in wouldn't be all that hard for you, Corporal, seeing as our shared family tree was planted somewhere around where you'll be.
While he rummaged through one of the open boxes for yet another donut, Idina had to fight hard not to grin at him.
Our shared family tree. If he wasn't the only officer here, he would never have said that out loud.
Bravo was and would always be the Hellion team who'd stood with Idina Moorfield and Colonel Richard McBlair to take down the Ulk on the back lawn of their childhood home. As family. There wasn't any point in pretending differently now. Richard tapped his newest donut against his lips and stared at the surface of the table.
I feel like I'm forgetting something. Primary objective, sir?
Briggs muttered. The colonel looked at him sidelong.
That's not obvious.
Well, if it's not being undercover in Scotland as American tourists, probably not.
The other operator snickered at that, and Richard didn't look remotely bothered by it.
Unfortunately for you, Sergeant, this isn't a military-funded vacation.
He slapped a hand on the table, as if only now remembering what this mission was supposed to accomplish.
Primary objective, Bravo Team.
Pinpoint the exact location of the source of these energetic disturbances and magical spikes. Once you've confirmed that location, engage and neutralize the target, whatever it is. I'm sure it goes without saying that completing this objective includes neutralizing any other supernatural entities you may encounter while... Sorry, you'll encounter them. Lots of them. Nobody wants to let too many of the little bastards slip through their fingers, but from what I've seen of the activity readings, I don't think 90% efficacy is beyond the scope of your team's abilities. Can't catch them all.
This is a two-parter then, sir?
Edgars asked.
Not counting the American tourist part?
Richard winked at him. It's more of a don't ignore the mobs that aren't your primary target kind of thing, if you can help it.
Bam made a noise, halfway between a growl and a low chuckle.
If we can help it.
Then his right eye twitched, and he dropped his head in his hands to massage his temples. The rest of the team didn't seem all that worried about Bam's odd little tics that had been popping up over the last 24 hours, and that was probably because so far, they hadn't changed a thing for anyone else.
He's either in serious pain, or didn't get enough sleep, or... something.
Idina wasn't sure she wanted to follow that one down the rabbit hole right now, but since she'd noticed, she couldn't exactly unnotice it.
What kind of density are we looking at out there, sir?
Briggs asked. Richard glanced at the ceiling.
It depends, really. On what, sir? The day, the weather, how many piles of sheep shit you step in per square mile.
With a shrug, Richard shook his head.
The only intel I care about, Sergeant, is what's causing the spikes in the brain's international readouts, and how quickly my best team handles the situation. The rest is up to you. Have we covered everything up to this point?
It was a redundant question the way he'd phrased it, but by now, Bravo was used to the Colonel saying what he thought, and meaning something slightly different than what he said. That awareness of their commanding officer made it a lot easier for the team to pick up on the one piece of this mission they hadn't covered yet. If Idina hadn't told them her suspicions last night, it probably would never have been brought up. It surprised everyone when Grossman was the one who voiced it.
This isn't a single entity we're looking for, is it, sir?
Richard cocked his head at the telepathic operator sitting beside his niece and hummed and thought.
I'm not sure what you mean, Grossman. But please, share with the rest of the class.
Grossman caught their sergeant's eye, and Briggs only raised an eyebrow in response. Clearly, their team leader didn't care one way or the other if they started talking about potential sources of all monsters in the entire world. At this point, the product of that conversation could only help Bravo's level of preparedness before they set off.
I'm talking about a source, sir,
Grossman added calmly.
You said it's still only speculation right now? That's all it is, Corporal.
Richard nodded and folded his hands on the table now that he was finished with his multiple donuts. An educated guess that has apparently made its way into Bravo's vast array of conversational topics. The Colonel's gaze flickered toward Idina again, and his smile widened.
Simply put, we don't know. If your team were to discover that these disturbances the brain picked up all the way out in Scotland are not the result of a single supernatural entity wreaking havoc on our cold-weather friends, I expect your sergeant to adjust strategic operations accordingly. Either way, your mission objective remains unchanged.
He probably didn't mean to show any reaction, but Briggs exhaled a loud, overwhelmed-sounding sigh and stared at the tabletop. The meeting room spent several more seconds in silence before Richard thrust a finger in the air and perked up, widening his eyes.
Here I am, making it sound like you'll be entirely on your own for the next... He glanced at his watch for no reason. However long this'll take you out there. I guess I've saved the best part for last. Or maybe it's another surprise none of you are surprised by.
Idina sat back in her chair and stared at her uncle. Yeah, that's right. I told them what we talked about. So go ahead and...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.